How is it working with B in the studio?
She is not like a regular human being, right? Yeah. Artist goes in and you have an engineer, you may have a vocal producer. She is someone that can do it all. Jay Brown was like, look, we got the 16-year-old girl that we signed from Barbados. Mm. She's young, she's still learning her voice. I need you to go up to upstate New York and go in the studio and work with her. Mm. I want you to vocal produce her. I want you to help her find her voice. I can remember during the B-Day sessions, we ordering Chipotle, and she was like, what is that Mexican y'all eating every day with the green stuff on top? And I would say, oh, that's Chipotle. You got it. Rob, go get her some Chipotle, please. Hold on. Chipotle with the guacamole.
Wait a minute. What we're establishing right now is that Makeba put Beyonce on the Chipotle.
Let's vibe this week.
That's the vibe.
That's the vibe we on.
That's the energy.
That's the energy. Welcome to another week of We Sound Crazy. Your boy Fillionaire is in the building. We in ATL still. What up?
Absolutely. Claude Kelly is in the building.
What's up? Chuck Harmony is in the building.
Bacon for making in the building. What's going on, y'all?
Man. We have songwriting royalty.
I was just about to say that.
And much more. Ooh. Royalty
and
in many
and much
ways.
More.
And so ooh. Many things, but came to ATL and had to talk to us. Go to the source.
Come to the source.
You know what I'm saying? The one and only Makeba Riddick.
Yeah. DMV stand up.
Listen. Royalty, DMV, like I said.
DMV stand up. DMV,
that's Baltimore, right?
That's Baltimore is a part of that little conglomerate right there.
So you're a proud DMV?
I am a proud Baltimorean. Honestly, you know, Baltimore got its own thing. I don't even know if we can be called the DMV.
She's seated.
Shots fired.
I mean, I'm just saying.
It's okay, Makeba. Just come on back. We embrace you.
Maryland has seceded from the treaty.
We got like our own thing going on, so you know.
I feel that.
Well, welcome, Makeba.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for having me. Yeah.
This is a celebratory time. You celebrated a birthday recently.
Yes.
And I said, you know what better way for us to celebrate and to come with your brothers if we sound crazy. So
Yes. Oh my gosh. Yes.
We have so much history that people don't know.
Oh my gosh.
We've been doing this a long time.
Yeah.
It's so crazy because the three of you, like, you all literally put together like the soundtrack. You were part of the soundtrack to my college years.
Wow.
That's crazy. Like,
that's just wild.
I feel so.
I was like, okay, make me feel old.
Y'all old and I'm old. It's crazy that I'm even sitting here with y'all. Like, it's just, it's mind-boggling.
So, wow.
Yeah, man.
We sound crazy. And I don't want no substitute.
Deja vu.
Deja vu. Wow. Good classic.
Good Lord. Good
classic.
Can you take us back to that session?
I will tell you, I've told this story so many times. Long story short.
Okay.
We had been at a writer's camp at Rodney. Rodney had this compound in Atlantic City, New Jersey. Mm. About 10 rooms in this building. Bunch of writers down. It was about 7 of us down there. And we had come through this writer's camp for about 2 weeks. And everybody was exhausted and everybody was leaving, right? Everybody was going home. I was ready to go home. And I had my bags at the door waiting for the cab to come get me. And Rodney comes running to the door like, Makeba, I just got this call from, I can't remember who it was at the time, but Janet Jackson's people. And she's working on a project and they need that last single. And I know we could do it. I mean, we had written songs for Brandy. We had written songs for Brittany. We had went in. For the past 2 weeks, I've really had nothing left. And he was like, come on, you and Kelly Nicole Price, come on. I know we could do this. And one of the other writers, Delisha, was there too. Everybody else had gone. And so we did this record for Janet, to pitch to Janet.
For Janet.
For Janet Jackson. Mm. I went back to New York And maybe about 9 months later, I got a call from Max Goose, who was working with Matthew Knowles at Music World at the time. And Max said, I think we have one of your demos. And I'm working with Matthew, and Beyonce's working on her album, and she wants to cut this record that we have. And I'm in my mind, I'm like, one of my records. Oh my goodness. I hope it's really one of my records. And he said, it's called Deja Vu. Let me play it for you. Played it over the phone. I said, yeah, that's one of the Rodney records. He said, well, look, we want to bring you to the studio, to Sony Studios, where she's working, to work on it and flesh it out and finish it with her. And you know, she got some other stuff she's working on. I'm like, You sure? Me? She want to work with me? He said, yeah, she wants to meet you. She wants to meet who did this record. Like, she loves this record. Mm. And so I was like, oh, okay. But in my mind, still thinking like, nah, this is not really happening. Don't even get too excited. And I felt like that up until I was pushing the door open at Sony Studios, and she was sitting right there. And so when I got in, she told me, oh, Jay loves the record. He wants to get on the record. We got to finish it ASAP. And that led to seven other records, co-writing seven other records with her.
So how did it go from the Deja Vu record to Upgrade You, Get Me Body, Sugar Mama, Creole, Worldwide One? Like, how did it go?
How did that happen?
How'd you end up bodying the whole album? Yeah.
The whole album. You know what happened? We hit it off so much that day when we cut Deja Vu. She wanted me to stay. She said, well, if you don't have to leave, I'd like you to stay. This is going to be my personal writing room. And I got some other records I want you to work on with us. And it was me and her and Angie and Solange.
Shout out to
Angie and Solo. And Rodney and his team in one room. Swiss and Sean Garrett in one room. And so it became like, at the end of every day, like a competition, like, okay, who got the hottest records today? What y'all been working on? And we would all come together at the end of each day and hear, you know, so everybody was trying to outdo each other. So me, I'm the girl wonder. I'm like, I need all of that. Come on, let's do another one. Come on, Angie, let's do another one. We doing this. And by the end of it, we had a whole album done.
How is it working with B in the studio? Like, is she quick with vocals? A lot of people don't know, like, just her recording process.
Yeah.
Because she's super behind the curtain with it, but, like,
That's like opening up the curtain at the Wizard of Oz and showing you all the
all the secrets.
I will say this. She is not like a regular human being, right?
Yeah.
As an artist, you know, an artist goes in and you have an engineer, you may have a vocal producer, you may have, you know, a lot of support for the artist. She is someone that can do it all.
Yeah.
Herself. And to the point where we would all be sitting back, me, the engineer's assistant, the writers, the producers, we're all sitting back just like learning, watching, like, wow, one person, like, she's comping all her own vocals. I've never seen anything like
that. So she'll get on me. She's amazing in the studio. She's quick. She can engineer herself. She is truly a producer.
Yeah, she's
like,
a real producer.
Like, it's unbelievable how quick. And just how her brain, like, I always say,
it's
you're not
science.
Human.
It's a science. I always say that. And what I saw that really blew me away is that one day she sang so much. She would say, okay, it'd be like 3:00 in the morning. Okay, guys, I'll see you back at the studio tomorrow at 12 noon. Give everybody a chance to get some rest, get some breakfast. I'll see you guys tomorrow. We'll get there at 12 noon. She's been there recording since 9.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And she will sing till she has no voice, right? And I'm like, B, you wanna
take a break?
No, it's okay. I'm gonna sing through it. And she would sing through that hoarseness and her voice will come back stronger than ever. I've never seen anything like that before.
That's crazy.
Yeah, she's a different animal. Yeah.
Different.
But on top of that, The greatest part of all of that is she is like one of the sweetest people I've ever met. Mm. You would think that somebody that's so successful, so talented, so accomplished, you couldn't even be in the same room with them. Mm. But she's one of the sweetest people that I've ever met before.
Mm. We sound crazy.
So if you get A&R for a day.
Yeah.
If you could, or the songs that you've written for this artist, who else could you hear on it?
Oh.
Or you wrote this song for this artist, but it wound up being cut by this artist, you know.
You go first.
Oh, okay. How we doing it? Tell me how we doing it.
Our A&R for a day. A song, let's start general. A song you heard recently.
Okay.
That you were like, oh, this would have been better or good on somebody else.
A song that I heard recently. Okay, so let me just put this disclaimer out, okay? What I'm listening to a lot lately, most of the time, I listen to CCM and country all day long,
wow,
right?
Yeah.
So I would say, and this is not a new song, but the first time I heard it, I was like, Ariana Grande would sound amazing singing this song, and it's Lauren Daigle's You Say.
That's good casting right there. A&R for a day.
Yes. I said, wow. Ariana Grande's voice on this, wow, would also be amazing.
That's good.
That is good.
Okay. I got another one for you.
Okay.
I got another one for you. So A&R for a day. Like you said, a song that you wrote for somebody else.
Okay.
That could have been a huge hit, but you had it as someone else in mind.
A song that I wrote.
Why you look at me?
Because there are so many songs.
No, because I think of a particular song that I wrote for one of Phil's artists. And you wanted to open up this door, so we're gonna open up this door. So I pitched Phil about 5 songs for this artist because I wanted to work with her so bad. I wanted to be on her project. I wanted to do something with her. And so I sent Phil the 5 songs, and he said, I listened to the songs, and they're good, but I just don't think they'll work for this artist. And that artist was?
Leandria.
Yeah.
Is this bigger than me?
It's during that window, during that time.
Oh,
man.
My God.
And so I was like, okay, cool. You know, we pitch songs all the time. Yeah. We pitch 100 songs before we get one placed, right? And so Phil was like, nah, none of these are going to work. So then he called me back about a month later, and he was like, you know what? One of these songs in here, it's called Won't He Do It. I have a new artist that I signed named Corinne Hawthorne. She's doing a spot on Greenleaf on, and she needs the song to sing with the choir or something like that. So the music supervisor loves the song, and she said we should have Corinne cut this song, and I think we should have Corinne cut it. And he was asking me, like, are you okay with that? Are you okay with that? And I was like, fine, whatever you say, Phil. If you think, you know, this is the artist. And so the song, she performed the song, it grew wings, as I say, and it took off and flew off into the stratosphere. But that song was, you know, I had pitched it for Leandra.
Actually, you know what? I got the demo.
Oh, wow.
So bad I thought I would die, but ain't no power stronger than the one that came and laid down his life. And I got mountains to climb, but the enemy can't stop me, cause there's a calling on my life. When I'm crying, don't last too long, cause he gon' step in and make it all right.
That's the platinum song, Won't He Do It.
Oh, yeah,
recorded by Corinne Hawthorne, who did not fully get the song at that time, if you remember.
Look, I give it to Phil, I give it to Angela Jolivet, the music supervisor, and Corinne, to be able to hear what that was going to be. Because when I tell you, I wrote that song in my friend's garage, I was going through it, I was facing an incredible legal battle, and this was my therapy, right? Mm. And so for Phil and them to even say, this could be something, That's crazy.
But Makeba, do you remember recording? Because we recorded for the show.
Yes.
And then it was originally a duet with one of the co-stars of the show, Rashawn. And I was like, Makeba, get Corinne to cut the second verse. Like, she, it was so
funny. Yeah. And you're like, yeah, that was tough. That wasn't easy. But
I'm a songwriter, so I can say this with a little bit of prejudice, but I love hearing songwriters' versions of songs.
Yeah.
Then you get the actual essence of what the song was envisioned to be.
Yeah.
Which is not anything taking anything away from Corinne's version, because she killed it and gave it wings and all that stuff.
Oh my goodness.
But there's something about the seed of the idea.
Yeah.
We do this all the time, and you hear, like, this is what came to me this day.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is how I interpret it. Like, you're just right in the pocket.
The pocket, bro.
Just sitting in there, and I was like I said, going through it. I think the Braxton Family Values or something was mm-hmm. playing on TV. Mm. And it was just all of those things, all of these different factors that caused me to write that song that day, not knowing, not thinking that it was going to be anything, because furthermore, I had never had a gospel song that came out to radio.
Yeah.
I had been writing with Rodney and LaShawn for years trying to get a gospel record mm-hmm. that come out, and nothing ever came out. And so I wasn't even thinking this was going to be anything. But
that's so interesting. That's a story of songs. Like, you have it intended for one person.
Yeah.
And it's most times, you're kind of glad that it was out of your control, because where it lands.
Absolutely. I always say the song will find a home. So now I don't labor over, I gotta get it on this artist. This artist gotta cut it. No, I don't care where it lands. As long as the artist loves it and they put their heart into it,
mm-hmm.
I'm good.
Yeah, for me being in this business, it was one of the first times I saw, because I was working with Phil at the label when this song took off, and to see that song literally grow legs.
Yeah.
And then
fly.
Like,
and then fly. And then fly. Legs and then
legs
wings.
Legs and then wings. And then working the song at radio, how it was like certain programmers, they resisted it.
Right.
They did?
Yeah. And then
why?
It was like, it was almost like they had no choice but to put it in.
I'll tell you why. Can I tell you why? Can I interject?
Yeah.
Because through that song was birthed a new sound. Yeah. In gospel music, right?
Okay.
And so I don't even call it gospel music. When she performed it on the BET Awards, they called it urban inspirational. Yeah. I call it rhythm and praise, right? Mm. This is a new sound. And I can understand how a lot of programmers did not understand it, because you think about, like, well, it sounds too hip for the traditional audience, you know, and then the young folk, you know, they don't really listen to gospel like that. Well, this is where we bridge the two worlds together,
mm-hmm.
right? And from there, we are starting to see more and more artists do that sound.
See, this is why I, again, preferential treatment, but this is why I say you gotta make friends with songwriters and producers, because outside of what gets told as a story of how things do, the crafting of how genres happen, the crafting of how sounds mm-hmm. happen,
yeah. mm-hmm.
the
yeah.
crafting of how movements and messages and catchphrases and all that stuff happens is in those ideas right there.
Yeah,
it's when Makeba's sitting down and say, like, I'm watching Braxton Family Values and I'm going through it. And I have this history of music in my head.
Yeah.
And I
grew up in the church, and I grew up listening to Biggie and Nas,
mm-hmm.
and I want to create this new genre for the Gen Z believers, the Gen Z Christians, right?
Mm.
Because they may not listen to the traditional gospel music that my grandmother was listening to. Let's give them something.
Mm. But Makeba, I want to take this time, because it took a lot of trust, you know, again, because no one knew Corinne at that time. I just signed her, so thank you for believing and just trusting me to know I wasn't going to let your baby go without mm-hmm. clothing and taking being taken care of. You know what I'm saying? But you and the producers and Kit Classic on the remix, who also came through on Unstoppable.
Yeah.
It just, I remember, because we were at the end of the record, which means the end of the budget.
Mm.
And they all believed. And I never, ever, ever forget that. And I just remember making a promise, like, y'all, just trust me on this one. I know it don't look good. I got this, but they were like, nah, we'll make it work. We'll make it work. And so I was committed to, team, we gotta make this happen for so many reasons, but thank you. It means a lot.
Thank God. Glory to God for that one.
So, one time is luck, but when you're able to do it over and over, over and over, it's part of who you are. It's in your DNA.
Mm-hmm.
So, when you talk about songwriting, what do you think that it is about your songs that resonate with so many people?
That's a good question. And I was thinking about this last night, because I came across a post by, you know, I Got Soul, this page that I follow. And they had posted Kenny G Love Green, who is, I don't know if you guys know who he is, but that's like one of my biggest inspirations. I'm telling you guys, from when I was like 10 years old, right? Mm-hmm. So bad I was such a fan, to the point I was 13 years old. I was at my family reunion in Virginia, I think it was.
DMV.
DMV. DMV. DMV. We was all in the pool, me and all my cousins, right?
Mm.
I saw Kenny G Love Green walking down the hall. I'm like, oh my God, that's my, oh my God, I'm fanning out. I said, I'm gonna go knock on his door. I'm just gonna go tell him how much of a fan, I just love his music. I did not know this man, but I just loved his music. I'm going, and my cousin was like, no, you're not. No, you're not. I said, yes, I am. Watch this. I saw where he went. I went and knocked on his door. He opened the door. I said, I'm such a huge fan of what you do. I'm going to follow in your footsteps one day. I'm going to be doing exactly what you're doing. And he was like, yeah, yeah, okay, thank you. Close the door. And his music just inspired me and touched me in such a way. I don't know. As songwriters and creators, the way that music touched me as a child, I don't know if everybody has this, but like, it actually brings out emotions.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
and so when I would listen to Intro and I would listen to Jodeci, Devontae Swing, is, I call him my music industry godfather. Mm. Those are the guys that inspired me to do what I'm doing today. And so I always said, if I can make music to touch people the way they did me, then that's, I'm doing what I'm supposed to do, and I'm going to do that. And so I just do what I love. I don't go in the studio saying, oh, I'm going to write this hit record, and I know what this is going to be, because I don't.
Right. I have no idea.
I have no idea.
Right, right.
I just go in, and I write what the music tells me to write. I write what I'm feeling, and then I let it go. And God does the rest.
I love that.
You know?
I love that. Kenny's pen was cold. I mean, I think about the intro records,
the Mary records.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yo, this, oh, my gosh.
Yo. I saw that post, and because you forget.
Yeah.
You forget. I love those posts because you forget how many songs that one producer or one songwriter's done.
Yeah.
I was like, dang, we've been sleeping.
We've been sleeping. Like, and I think of like now when I meet new songwriters, the young songwriters and producers, and they tell me, oh, I all the songs you wrote, the soundtrack to my college years. And I think back to like when I was this, and I would see Kenny G Love, Devontae Swing, Missy Elliott. Mm-hmm. I'm reading all the credits and who wrote what. And I'm like, wow, I'm that person now.
Yes.
You know? It's a bug out.
It's so crazy because I'm like, you're sharing your story, but I know that's Claude's story, and I know that's my story. We're reading credits, and we so inundated in this music business. I don't know how we knew to do that. How did you know to do that?
What, to read the credits?
Yeah, just how did you know to just deep dive like that?
Because I wanted to know who was writing this. Mm. Who in the world came up with these arrangements? Who is that?
Yeah.
I want to know, what school did they go to? Where they from? So I found out that Casey and JoJo were originally from Baltimore. Mm. And so I just started, and Devontae and Dalvin was from Virginia. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to know. I wanted the history on everybody.
Mm. That's how I was.
Yeah, yeah.
I wanted the history. Where you from? Who you? What church did you go to?
Straight
who
up.
Your father was who? Okay.
And you remember, like, this is way before the information age.
Yeah.
You could just Google and figure it out. Like, it was true investigative reporting.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Like, you were
deep diving. Deep diving.
I was cold calling record labels.
Same. I would just send letters.
Too.
I
would
just
too.
Open the, I'm like, oh, you're at Sony? What's this? Open the yellow pages. Where's Sony at?
Right.
Calling the front, the switchboard, like, hi, yes, I'd like to speak to Clive Davis, please.
But that's how I got my internship back then. I literally called Arista, 1-800-6 Arista was the number.
Wow.
That's cold call.
Yeah, just cold calling.
Yeah.
I was interning.
You want to be down.
You want to be down. I was interning for Epic when I first started, and interning for Polly Anthony, who was the president at that time. So I had access to her whole Rolodex. Mm. So I'm looking through the Rolodex. She want me to call this person. She want me to call this person. I said, Rodney Jerkins. I'm going to call him. I'm going to just see. So I called. I said, hi, Rodney. I met you at the Impact Convention, and you told me to give you a call. Can you give me a call back, please, at your earliest convenience? And he called back.
Wow.
He called back. And when I got home to Brooklyn, I had a message on my machine, and he said, hey, this is Rodney Jerkins. I got a call from you. I said, okay, it's meant to be. It's meant to be for me to work with him.
We sound crazy.
Rihanna, Rude Boy.
Rihanna.
So
how I met Rhi was, you introduced us. That's how I first met her.
Is that when you met her?
Yeah.
At the birthday party?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was a, I get a call from Makeba one night. She's like, yo, I'm having a gathering at my friend's house in the Hollywood Hills. Her friend was Rihanna. Mm-hmm. And so I get to, because I'm cool with CB.
But I hadn't told you who the friend
you
was.
You didn't tell me who the friend was. Yeah,
yeah, so you were just like, come to my
friend. Just come to my friend.
I was, and here's the reason why, because she said, we having a little get together at the crib tonight. Invite some people over, invite some of your friends, tell them come through. Mm. Okay, Phil, come through. We're gonna be kicking it at the crib.
And me and Tristan Wiles came through there, hung mm-hmm. out, and it was just like, we got to the crib. I'm like, looking around, like, this is Rihanna crib. Like, your friend is real. She's hosting. She's like, do you guys need anything to drink? Anything to eat? Like, you know, it's food. I'm like, it's the host with the most. But, that's how I first met Rhi, was by way of Makeba.
Yeah.
So talk
that's
to
crazy.
Us.
That's a crazy way to meet her is at her crib from Rhi.
You did so much work with Rhi. Like,
yeah.
Like, how did that journey start?
It started when I was a youngin' in New York City. Mm-hmm. I was working with Jay Brown and Tata. And we were working on Megan Rochelle. Mm-hmm. They also had Tierra Marie signed to Def Jam. Yeah. And
because you were actually an A&R for Roc Nation during that period, right?
No, this was before Roc Nation. This was before the Roc Nation deal. This was Def Jam. This was when Rihanna first got signed to Def Jam. And so Jay Brown was like, look, we got this girl, this 16-year-old girl that we signed from Barbados. Mm. She's young. She's still learning her voice. I need you to go up to upstate New York and go in the studio and work with her. Mm. I want you to vocal produce her. I want you to help her find her voice. Mm. And I'm like, Jay, I mean, she's a new artist. And, you know, I'm going to have to be up there babysitting.
It's a lot of work.
Yeah. And he was like, Just go. I'm telling you, there's something about this girl. She's special. She got it. We just need to find that sound. And so I went up there, and there was a 16-year-old Rihanna who had just gotten to America, and she was working with Sterkins and Rogers, and mm-hmm. just a young girl just trying to figure it out, you know, figure out her sound. And so I did a record called If It's Loving That You Want with Tone and Polk, mm-hmm. which became her second single after Upon a Replay went top five. Mm-hmm. And we just hit it off. You know, she began to really trust me, not only as a songwriter, but just as another female in the business. Mm-hmm. You know, she's here with no family. She don't really know a lot of people. And so that's how we cultivated that early mm-hmm. relationship. And the records were coming out so crazy, and LA and Jay and all of them were like, we need that sound again and again and again. So not only was I writing, but then songs that I didn't write, like Unfaithful, like Disturbia, I would have to go with her and cut those vocals until she felt like, this is it. This is my sound. I need Makeba here. I don't care where I am in the world. I need her here to you know. Yeah. So that's how the relationship started, in that I think because she was a young female, and I was a young female myself, but she felt like, okay, here's somebody else that I can trust in this business, you know?
As someone who was there from the beginning of Rihanna's career, we all have our reasons why we love Rihanna.
Yeah.
From your vantage point, why do you think the world just clamors for Rihanna? Anything that she does.
Yeah.
Whether it's a song on a movie soundtrack, mm-hmm. she's having the Amazon Prime fashion show. Yeah. Like, we eat it up every time.
Some Fenty draws.
Yeah. What is it about her that just, she sticks to our ribs?
I think that she is authentically her. And a lot of times with artists, when they are trying to find themselves, they go through a lot of different phases of who they could be, who they should be, who people want them to be, to, mm-hmm. okay, this mm-hmm. is who I really am, and this is what you're getting. You know, with Rihanna, it was like that from day one. Mm-hmm. She never had to find herself. She was who she was, right? And if you didn't like it, you didn't like it. Like, I remember when she cut her hair, they didn't want her to cut her hair on Good Girl Gone Bad and get the tattoos. But she was like, this is me. This is who I am. And I think that the world can see that. Mm. The world can see if you are being phony and you're not really the person that you portraying to be, there's going to be a disconnect between the artist and the fans. She is just authentically, this is me. And I think people love that about her.
Mm. I agree with that.
Yeah.
I 100% agree with that.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite song that you created with Rhi?
A favorite. We did so many songs.
It's probably something we ain't even heard.
Ooh, yeah, well, I mean, I got demos with Re and Eminem that never came out. Re and Jay that never came out.
What?
I mean, we got so many songs. Oh my goodness. You know, I vocal produced the entire Rated R album, which Rude Boy came from that album. And that was just a classic body of work. Song for song.
A young Russian Roulette.
Yes, to Russian Roulette. Yeah, yeah. Oh my gosh. Just song for song, just a classic body of work. Of course, you know, you're always going to think about the singles, right? Rude Boy was number one for 7 weeks on the top of Billboard. So, I mean, I guess that's a favorite. Mm. It's just that period in my life will be something that I never forget because I made a friend. I made a family member, and we kind of like grew up together.
Mm. Yeah, I remember every time I would call McKeven, I'm like, "Well, yeah, I'm in London. I'm in Australia. I'm in New York." I'm like, "When are you home, friend? I want to hang out with my friend." She would be out. Like, her and Reed would be around the world, literally.
Yeah, we recorded that album around the world. We went every place was a different song.
I know seeing her at the Super Bowl had to be such a...
Right.
Wow.
What did you feel? What was that feeling?
You know why that was such a bug out? Because now, which was not then, but now I have 3 little ones. Mm-hmm. And they're like singing the songs and they're
That's
singing.
Crazy.
And my husband is like, "You know, mommy wrote that song?" And they're like, "Shh, come in." And so for me, that was like, wow. That warmed my
that's
heart.
So amazing.
That's full circle.
Yeah, yes, full circle.
Let me say this. I'm so proud of the class of musicians that I came in the game with because we were formidable. We were informed people.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Like, we really wanted to chase the greatness.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? We really were trying to be Quincy Jones.
Yeah.
We really were trying to be these people. So I'm proud of us.
I'm proud of us.
And shout out to Berkeley. I guess that's just where I do it.
Shout out to Berkeley.
Berkeley in the building.
Don't hate on us.
We sound crazy.
That's one of my favorites. That's actually one of my favorite songs. That Surrounds You by Fantasia.
By Young Tage.
Yeah.
I was getting ready to say that's like top 3.
Really?
Top 2. Probably of my favorite songs that I ever wrote in my
career.
Yeah,
I love, when I tell you I love that song, I listen to it like I didn't write it. I'm just jamming out when I hear that song.
So speaking of your favorites, if you had to rank, I know you love all your babies. I know, I get it, right? But if you had to say, these are my top 5 babies. These are my favorite creations that are near and dear. And again, for whatever reason, but clearly Surround You is in that top 5.
Oh, yeah.
What would be in that remaining 4 slots?
Love and War.
Mm. Celebrating a 10th anniversary, if you will. Shout out Tamar Braxton.
Shout out to Tamar. But Love and War. You know, I wrote that with LaShawn Daniels, who was my brother. Blood couldn't make us closer. And that's a very special record. And I wrote that like right after I had my first daughter.
Really?
It just means that record. And then to see what it did.
Well, let me tell you something. Just from, because there are always great songs every year, but there are certain songs that change the trajectory of how people start to create afterwards. It happens every couple of years.
Yeah.
But there's always this challenge of how can we insert, especially the last 20 years, how can we get ballads?
Yeah.
How can we get real singers to the forefront? And when Love and War came out, first of all, there's nothing like it.
Right.
Nothing like it out of the time. Went straight to number one, which is why you see the fanfare for it 10 years later, where fans are on stage singing it to her.
Yeah.
But what it also allowed was for other creators who were in the studio dying to write something with chord changes.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Dying to have permission to let a singer be a singer.
Yeah.
Do that.
We sound crazy.
Let me just say this.
Sing, Makeba.
That's way outside of my range, right?
I don't believe that one bit.
But one thing, LaShawn always pushed me, right? He said, if you got a screech, get it out there. Get it out because it's just warming. It's warming that part of your range up. And so I was like, LaShawn, I don't know. This is high. He said, don't worry. Tamar could do that in her sleep. Don't worry. And so to see what it has become 10 years later, it touches my heart. Every time I see her perform that song, she performed, I don't know if she was in Detroit one time or where she was, but Kiara Shear came out on stage and sang A Piece of Love and War. When I tell you, I was throwing stuff. I was like, wow. So that song is very dear to my heart and forever will be.
Yeah, three slots.
All right, so Love and War, Surround You. Live Your Life. Live Your Life. Let me tell you about that one right there.
That's a whole ministry right there.
Yes.
Live your life. You steady dressing up that car, just live your life.
Live Your Life. Just Blaze had that hook. And Mike Caron had it at Atlantic, and T.I. was at Atlantic at the time, and they said, this has the potential to be a pop record. This has the potential to be huge, right? Bigger than just a rap record. And T.I. was like doing his thing at that time. And so Jay Brown called me and said, they want to put Rihanna on the record, and we need you to go in and do something. How can we incorporate her into the record to make it, you know, what it can be? And so I was just coming back from London with the Black Eyed Peas, again, exhausted. I had just landed in New York. And I was going to stay in New York for 24 hours and then go back home to L.A. And so as soon as I landed, I got this call from Jay Brown. I said, okay, yeah, I'll do it. I'll do it as soon as I get back to L.A. I'll go do a demo. We'll cut it on her. He said, well, see, here's the thing. They need the record by, like, Tuesday. Mind you, this is Saturday. Rihanna is in Milan prepping for a show. They need to mix and master by Tuesday. I said, what can we do? He said, I need you to get on a plane and go to Milan tonight. And I'm like, I just landed. I'm just coming from one time zone back to America. Now you want me to go 14 hours back the other way. So I'm on a plane. I'm writing ideas on a plane. I'm recording ideas on a plane. And by the time I got to Milan, well, actually, we had a layover in Munich, Germany. I was delirious, right? I had been in all these different time zones. I literally was delirious. I'm in the airport in Munich, and I'm just thinking, like, where am I going? You know, where am I going right now? And I saw this man walking towards me. I didn't know who it was because I'm literally so exhausted. It was Rihanna's manager, Mark Jordan, at the time. And he was like, come on, Makeba, I know you tired. I'm a pull you through this airport so we can get this done. Finally got to Milan. I'm in the car, sleep. I didn't even know when we got to the hotel, nothing. Had to go to the studio that night to get the song done. We got the song done, and Craig Coleman called me, and he said, listen, we got to smash. You don't even know what this is about to be. And I recognize your sacrifice, so we're going to give you 3 days in Milan to go and do you, all expenses paid, anything what? You want to do.
Wait.
Yeah.
Shout out to Craig Calvin at Atlantic.
Craig. Call me. All right. Call me, Craig. I'm tired.
I've been living wrong.
I'm going to go to Milan, Craig.
How old Milan?
What? That's no, but.
Yeah,
but
no, it was hard work. Yeah. And, oh, my goodness. That was tough. But came back to America and it immediately came out. Because usually, you know, once you cut a song on a record, an artist on the record, you don't know when it's coming
Weeks,
out.
Months, years.
Weeks, months, years.
Yeah.
It immediately came out and then, you know, took off.
When that Atlantic starts moving, boy.
Yeah. When that button gets pressed,
especially the Atlantic button.
Yeah.
He said, hold on.
So you got Live Your Life, you got Surround You, Love and War.
Love and War.
And you got two more out of the Makeba all time, you know, top five.
Okay. Won't He Do It, right? Won't He Do It was also a game changer.
Won't He Do It,
you
said you would. Fight your battles
for you, they gon' wonder how you sleep at night. Won't He Do It. Again, I had never had a gospel record to come out. And I grew up in the church, and, you know, my walk with God has been for a very long time. But I was thinking in my mind, like, on the gospel side, right? I didn't even know if I could have the same impact and the same success as I had had with my other records,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so God said, hold up, let me show you something. When that record came out.
He was like, won't I do it though?
What, right, won't I do it?
Won't I do
it? Right. When that record came out, what I learned was real impact, right? Mm-hmm. Changing lives.
Mm-hmm.
We were getting letters and messages from around the world about what Won't He Do It was doing in people's lives.
Mm.
We got this, somebody sent me a video of this lady who has suffered 7 miscarriages, right? And so the video that was sent to me, she was coming down the hallway on the gurney. All the nurses and doctors was outside, and Won't He Do It, outside in the hallway, was playing, and everybody was dancing. She had delivered her baby, mm-hmm. right? And they were saying that they played Won't He Do It in the delivery room. And I was like,
wow.
Impact.
Then we got another message from a little girl's mother here in Atlanta, who the little girl was at this time 4 years old. She had been battling cancer for 2 years. Mm-hmm. Right? And so the mother had told us that when the little girl gets the treatments, she's so weak and she's so sick, she can't even talk, she can't even move.
Mm.
And so the video that they sent to us, they had brought her whole family down to the hospital and they were all singing Won't He Do It, right? And she got up and she perked up in the bed and she was able to get up and move a little bit. And the mother thanked me. She said, this is what your record is doing for my little girl.
That's crazy.
And so I was like,
because you and Cochran actually visited.
And then we went to go see her at the hospital, and Cochran actually sang it for her in person.
Wow.
And
yeah.
So it's just like, I was like,
those real life moments.
Oh my gosh,
yeah.
Real. Okay, these songs are really out here doing something to people's hearts, you know?
And that's what music is for, really.
Yeah.
To see lives. That song at Praise in the Park here in Atlanta. And you see a crowd of people singing that song word for word. And there was one, in particular, one young lady standing there with tears coming down her face. Won't it, like,
listen,
it was crazy.
People tell me that.
I got chills.
The music supervisor who got this record for Greenleaf, she said, the day I heard that demo, I was driving and tears just started coming down my face. And I'm thinking to myself, in my mind, I'm just like, you know, I don't see it that way. I don't feel it that way. But whatever's coming out of me, people feel it, you know, in such a way. So
I don't know if it's a maturity thing or it just takes time to realize it. But especially when you're on the fast track on the pop, hip hop, R&B side.
Yeah.
You know your records have impact because the numbers are telling you and Billboard's telling you and all that. Like, you know, the records are big.
Yeah.
But you don't really feel the human-to-human impact.
No, you don't.
You know that far and wide, the song's on the radio. And
yeah.
Yes, I made it and all that's cool. But then there's a moment, and I think it's a moment in life, if you continue to write, if you keep going, where you start to realize where your songs are medicine.
Yeah, yeah.
Right?
Medicine, yes.
Medicine.
Yes.
And that's a whole other level of a relationship with music, too.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, no, now I see where this is, like, spiritual, and it's healing, and it's healing me as it's healing you, and watching you heal is healing me even more. And
right.
It's that constant give and take.
I think for me, because I've always written from a personal space, like 98% of the songs that y'all hear that other people cut, I'm writing about something that's going on in my life.
Same thing with me.
Same thing, right?
Whether it's for a guy or a girl, it's just the intention of the record.
Yeah. I'm writing about something that I'm directly dealing with. So, you know, I'm thankful for Won't He Do It because it showed me the impact of what a record, beyond just the radio, beyond just the party, you know.
That song had impact. Now, like, what's the last,
one more.
The fifth slot,
ooh,
the fifth baby that you like, this one is extra special.
This is tough. This is really tough. Can it be a cross between?
Can I say it's a cross between? Whatever you want, yeah.
It's a cross between Get Me Bodied. Right? Because anywhere in the world that I go, you're going to hear Get Me Bodied. Mm-hmm. I remember I was in Spain with Rihanna one time. We was in the mall. They shut the mall down. They put everybody out the mall so that we could shop. And then they started playing Get Me Bodied. I'm like, how do they know, right? But anywhere in the world that I go, they playing that record. So that's, of course, that's got to be up there. And, you know, we remade Ave Maria for Beyonce. Ave Maria. It wasn't until then, when we started working on that record, that I learned what Ave Maria means, right? And Ave Maria means basically like, thank God. To God be the glory, basically, you know? And so that one, when I hear her perform that record, it always does something to me. Because if you listen to the lyrics, we talk about, like, if I had never met you, you know, we wouldn't be here right now. If I had never, if this, thank God for that. Thank God for this moment. So that's another one of my favorite ones.
That's all the intention behind it.
The
record.
Intention,
yeah. Can I ask you a light hit songwriter flex question?
Yes.
Those moments when you're in public, right, and people might not know who you are.
Yeah.
And your record comes on.
Yeah.
You get to watch people vibe into your record.
Yeah.
Best feeling ever, right?
Best feeling ever. Wait a minute, I'll tell you, I'll do you one better. I was having some work done in my house the other day, and the guy that was doing the work, it was him and another guy, and I got all my plaques up in my keeping room. And he walked through the keeping room. Just in passing, as he was going outside, he said, oh, you a big Rihanna fan, aren't you? You really like Rihanna, don't you? I said, yeah. I said, yeah, I do, actually.
Yeah,
yeah,
she's great.
She's pretty great.
She's pretty awesome, yeah.
But we talked about B, we talked about Re, but we got to go to the beginning.
And it's crazy, but oh, baby, it don't matter whatever, don't faze me.
I don't believe. Wanna leave like this.
All I have, Jennifer Lopez and LL Cool J.
Wow, that started it all.
Written by our guest this week, Makeba Riddick-Woods.
Yeah, let's just put this to bed right now, though. Let me, because every time I post this song, people or Jennifer posted, people in the comments like, "Oh, y'all hear Ashanti on the background?" No, that's not Ashanti on the background.
It's not Ashanti on the background.
It's not Ashanti on the background.
Who is it,
Makeba? That's me.
Who is that, Makeba?
That's the girl Wanda.
That's the girl Wanda. Please don't ever get it twisted.
Don't get it twisted. No, that was my the first record that ever came out to radio, and my first record that went number one around the world. And I was so young at that time and just getting started. I had no idea what that meant. Mm-hmm. I had no idea what a number one record meant. And somebody tried to show me, like, well, right here it says a listening audience of 600 million people.
Right.
Do you understand what that means? I didn't understand what it meant at that time.
It's still hard to really understand that.
That's hard to grasp.
It's hard to grasp. But now when I think about it, and I was just telling somebody this the other day, as a songwriter, right? Mm-hmm. We are writing something in our, you know, private corner of the world that connects with millions of people.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
Yeah, it's crazy.
You know, and that was one of those records that opened the door for me to, you know, to do it over and over and over again. And I could have never fathomed that I would do that times 13.
How did you connect with J-Lo though? Like, that was one of your first placements.
That's crazy. So how did I connect with J-Lo? So the demo, me and my friend, once again, playing around in Brooklyn with DJ Ron G, who was a popular DJ in New York. And he had this sample and a track that he wasn't even really serious about at the time, right? But he gave the track to Max Goose. Max Goose gave the track to me. Me and Curtis Richardson playing around in Brooklyn with this song.
Shout out to Curtis Richardson. What up, homie?
What up, Curtis? Listen, Curtis is the one that told me. He said, one day, you're going to be great. He said, you don't know it now. You can't see it now because the grind is just so hard. But one day, you're going to look back. You're going to have songs all over Billboard. So shout out to Curtis.
Shout out to Curtis.
My first writing partner when I got to New York. So we were just playing around when we wrote this record because, you know, there was some things going on with Jennifer at that time. And we wrote about it, right? Just as like a parody and some kind of way. I think Ron G gave the demo to Max Goose. Max Goose gave the demo to Dave McPherson. Shout out to Dave McPherson, who gave the demo to Corey Rooney, right? Wow. Now, I promise you this. It may sound cliche, but I promise you this is the truth. I'm in my Brooklyn apartment, right? I probably had a can of tuna fish and cereal for the last 2 weeks because I was on my grind, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking to myself, like, this is never going to happen for me. Like, I've been grinding. I've been working. I'm exhausted. I don't have nothing. I done graduated college. Mm-hmm. Like, this is not it, right? Mm-hmm. I'm going back to Baltimore. I got my business degree. I'm going to, you know. And my phone rang, and it was Dave McPherson.
Right.
I'm telling you. I promise you. Because I was ready. I was done.
But for the audience, Dave McPherson was a big executive at Epic Records at the time, J-Lo's label.
So. Right. J-Lo's label. And he did this album, This Is Me Then album. And he said, how soon can you get down to the Hit Factory? Corey Rooney is there, who was J-Lo's executive producer at the time. And they wanna cut this record, All I Have, that you did. Is that you singing on the backgrounds? Come on down and help us out with the backgrounds. And I was like, I'm there. What time? What time y'all need me?
I'm already outside.
I'm already outside of the Hit Factory. And I walked in the Hit Factory, and I was like, blown away. All these plaques on the wall. All of this. I'm like.
Yeah, that Hit Factory in New York was
nuts. Yeah, that was nuts. That was nuts.
All them studios are gone now, but there was so much legacy.
So much history. We did the B-Day album right across the street at Sony Studios. So, yeah, that's how All I Have was born. And then after that, I did more records with her. I did Hold You Down with Fat Joe. I did a bunch of stuff with Corey Rooney and J-Lo. So, yeah.
Okay, so hold on. We're at the beginning of the career. I want to give you your flowers. Then I also want to talk about, from a songwriting perspective, those early years. Because that's that misty area where people don't know where the hard work happens.
Yeah.
But just a little history. How I came to know of the Girl Wonder was I got to Berkeley as you were leaving.
Yeah.
And the woman myth and legend was Makeba, because she had left Berkeley and gone to New York, which everyone there, I mean, when you're in Boston is a
Boston
big city.
Boston is close to New York, too.
But also not in any way entertainment business either way New York is. So you're always dreaming of getting to an Atlanta, New York, LA. So for all of us still sitting in the classroom, the word was that Makeba was dope. You, one of the best voices out there. She could write, and that she'd gone to New York and had made it.
Mm.
So giving you your flowers was that what you don't know was that we didn't know how hard it was in New York, but you have no idea how many students back at Boston you inspired to even be a songwriter.
Wow.
Because everyone's talking about you.
Wow. Wow, little did you guys know I had skipped out on my graduation. I had skipped out on my degree because I was trying to get this internship for like 3 years. The whole time I was in Berkeley, I was trying to get this internship, right? Mm. As soon as I got word that they were going to let me come and intern at Epic, I packed all my stuff and I was gone, right? I ain't taking none of my finals, nothing. So I called Don Gorder, who was the president of the music business department at the time. I said, Don, I got the opportunity of a lifetime. I can intern. I got this opportunity to intern for Polly Anthony, the president of Epic Records. You got to let me go. I said, I know I owe finals. I know I owe. He was like, look, if you can do it from New York, fax it back to us. Just do the best you can. I'm going to let you get your degree. Wow. And I had not finished, right? At that time, I had not finished. I'm going to let you get your degree. Go and get the real life experience. And so that's what I did. But then, I made a beeline to New York.
The myth was that she's out there. She's killing it, yo. She makes it. We all got to get it. We all got to. So that these are part of the reasons why we back then even knew songwriting was a career. Because no one tells you, hey, you can go and you can be a songwriter.
Yeah.
You kind of stumble into it. So Lil Eddie, was my friend from in New York.
Okay.
And you were working. So when I came out of Berkeley, he was like, yo, I'm in the studios already. So I'm like, well, I'll drive you to the studios, whatever. So literally I tagged along with him to Bad Boy.
Yeah.
And Makeba was running shit at Bad Boy.
Yeah, we when I tell you grinding, like for real, I lived out in Canarsie, Brooklyn. Right? All the way the last stop on the L train before you get to Coney Island. right? So that's two trains and a bus to get out there. So on a good day, like during the regular traffic time, it may take me about 2 hours to get home. But when I'm coming out the studio at 2 a.m. in the morning, 3 in the morning, and trains are running every hour and a half.
A young black woman by herself.
By myself. In NYC. It's nobody on the train but me and rats and homeless people.
Different times.
When I tell you I was fearless, I think about it now. Like, I go to New York now, I don't even want to be on the elevator by myself.
Or your kids, you know, what if your kids were doing.
Oh, my gosh. I couldn't. I it's no way I could let my kids do that.
Right.
Right? My family knew that, you know, I'm from West Baltimore. We that's a different,
you know, what's up? Right.
We were raised differently, you know. I was fearless. I would come out the studio 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm out there by myself. It's not a soul around. It was nothing but God that was with me during that time. So I get all the way home, have enough time to shower, get a bowl of cereal, and make that journey back to the studio. Because now I got my internship, I got my temp job, and then I got to go back to the studio at night.
Hustling,
so
man.
Hustling.
That's the songwriter's hustle.
Yeah.
Like lots of hunger, lots of sacrifice, lots of terrible studios and seedy places with weird people that you shouldn't be in rooms with, all kind of stuff like that for keeping it funky.
Yeah.
To sharpen your skills
and
get better, and then those relationships. Because like, what happens is that you start to create like a, well, this is for everyone. Like I'd heard about Chuck before I met him. There's like, yo, there's this person, just making this music out of this room. And that was Makeba. He's like, yo, her demos, yo, like, wait till you hear it. It's crazy. So literally, by the time all this stuff was exploding, you didn't know there was a whole trail of people that were coming behind
you. I had no clue. By the time I did my first publishing deal, literally, I was so stretched like a rubber band. I was at the end of that rope, right? And then what happened, right? This was when the rope broke off, right? And I had nothing left but faith. What happened was, okay, I lived in Brooklyn. I worked in Manhattan. My stop for my temp job was Bryant Park, okay? I came to work this morning, right? Just like I usually do. One of the stops was the World Trade Center, and then after the World Trade Center was West 4th. This particular day, we went right past the World Trade Center. I was like, we skipped the World Trade Center. When we got to West 4th, we sat there for like 10 minutes. And I'm like, what is going on? Everybody's like, what is going on? Then people started filling the trains. Everybody was hysterical, crying. I'm like, what the hell done happened? So I got off at Bryant Park. My phone, let's say it was not even 9 o'clock. It was like 8:55. I had 19 missed calls. I said, what is going on? I get to Fifth Avenue. Everybody from New York City is outside pointing down towards downtown. I could see the fire, right? But I just thought it was a fire. I didn't know what it was. Got upstairs to my temp job, and the second building was falling. Ooh. So I'm thinking to myself, I was just on a train that came under a building that was falling, right? And like, my world was shook, of course. You can imagine that day was like, oh my gosh. But I realized that God has saved my life. God has saved my life for something. Because I was on the train coming under the building, right? And so, of course, everything shut down in New York. You know, I got laid off. And at that point, I told God, I said, okay, God, this is all I got. I got 9 months to stay here in New York. And either I'm going to get this deal, something's going to happen for me, or I'm out. I'm going to go do something else. And at the end of those 9 months, I was signing my publishing deal. Signing my first publishing deal
at the end.
So many, many parts of that grind in my story kept me in it, you know, but it was that 9/11 that happened that really kind of like I had nothing left, you know, that was
it. What was the thing that kept you going? Like, what was that? It's because any ordinary person would just say, you know what, after the first three disappointments,
yeah,
it's like,
I can't do it. Yeah,
I'm done.
What else could I do? I couldn't do anything else. Yeah. You know, I've only ever done music my whole life.
It's a love of music.
It's the love of music.
We always tell people, like, when they ask us, what do you do to get in the game, or what's your advice? I'm like, if you don't love this, then leave now.
Yeah, if you don't love it, if you're not passionate about it. I can remember when I first got to New York, staying on my cousin's couch in Jamaica, Queens. Now, mind you, this Jamaica, Queens is like a different world out there. Like, I had never
seen. Shout out Jamaica, Queens.
Shout out to Jamaica, Queens. But it was an adjustment for me.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, when I got off the train, all those people, all these dollar cars. I mean, yeah. I was like a foreigner in New York, you know. And even then, I was like, how am I going to survive this?
Yeah.
This is like not my element, you know. But I loved music so much. Mm-hmm. I just didn't want to do anything else. It wouldn't let me go.
It's also like when I listen to stories, and I just watched the Tyler Perry documentary, which is good. I suggest people watch it. But it's also this uncanny belief in yourself.
Yeah.
Belief that what you have to offer the world is valuable.
Yeah.
And a lot of times we don't highlight that part, partly because we like to be humble, but it really is. It's a belief that you have something to say that is valuable to other people that keep you going. And I hear that in your story.
Too. Yeah. Yeah. Going back to what I was saying earlier, I was so inspired by the music that I grew up on. I wanted to make somebody else feel that, you know?
Yep.
I love that.
It's the only regret I have, and this is for all of us really, is that the business can be so tough sometimes that we're not more helpful to each other in the moment because we're all just trying to figure it out.
Yeah,
as crabs in a barrel. In a lot of ways, you're fighting for a couple slots on the album. You're fighting for a couple jobs at the label. Yeah. You're fighting for a couple dollars, even though there's usually a lot more dollars than they.
There's always more.
Always more dollars than they're offering you, but to hear you tell it now. And hear how identical it is to my story.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just a couple of years behind you, and to hear how identical it is to your story and all of ours in different ways, that's what I think the power of this podcast is.
Yeah.
Is that the little Makebas, the little Claus, little Chucks, little Phils, Timones that you said were just like you, reading them credits. Yeah. This is the new credits.
I remember sitting at Berkeley and one of the producers from Bad Boy had came up to Berkeley, Young Lord. And I wanted to meet him, and I was like shaking as I was going up to, I'm a songwriter, and I would love to get some tracks from you one day. And now he calls me every day, like, Makeba, when we get back, you know, so.
Yeah, your heroes become your friends.
Yeah, your heroes become your friends, for sure.
Speaking of friends, like, just in hearing you tell your story.
Yeah.
A common thread that I'm kind of pulling from your story is the fact that you, I guess in a sense, you create a safe space for the people that you work with. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about your approach to relationships and how you've been able to make Rihanna feel safe, make Beyonce feel safe someone that, you know, you're just meeting Beyonce for the first time, but she's like, hey, come in.
Yeah.
I want you to write these songs. Mm-hmm. And then you become her friend. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Talk about just your approach to relationships.
You know, people have always told me, you never can, like, put a mirror up in front of you and look at all of your characteristics, right? You are just who you are. Mm-hmm. But people have always told me that I have, like, a nurturing spirit, like a motherly kind of, you know? And so I guess that's what it is. People feel that, like, I want to take care of you. I don't want nothing to happen to you. You know, I can remember during the B-Day sessions, we would order, this was like when Chipotle first came out. So we ordering Chipotle, and she was like, what is that Mexican y'all eating every day with the green stuff on top? And I would say, oh, that's Chipotle. You got it. Rob, go get her some Chipotle, please.
Hold on.
She got it.
Hold on.
Chipotle with the guacamole.
Wait a minute. What we're establishing right now is that Makeba put Beyonce on the Chipotle.
Listen, we kept
Chipotle. That's the part
Chipotle.
That's going to go viral. None of this information is going to matter.
Exactly. We kept Chipotle in business at that time because we were like ordering Chipotle every day. But I just think it's the fact that I care, right? Mm-hmm. I'm not coming in just to, oh, I'm going to write this song for you and then I'm out. Like, I care about you as an artist. If it's too many people coming in and out the room, lock the door. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to create a safe space for the artist. Yeah. That's the only way that they can feel like they want to create, you know, and be at their highest level. So that's just me,
that's
man.
Gift.
I just want to take care of everybody.
That's a gift though, because you can be able to, you can write really good songs and you can still have terrible interpersonal relationships.
Right, absolutely.
You can write great songs and you still can't sing.
Mm. Yeah.
All those things. Like, but to be able to write a song, pitch a song.
Yeah, because that's an art in itself.
Pitch a song to label, which is a one kind of a pitch, and then pitching to an artist is a whole different kind of a
Yeah.
There's a creative pitch and a business pitch. Yeah. Get in the room with the artist, not make them feel inferior because you're insanely talented yourself. Let them feel like it's about them. Let them feel comfortable. Get the best vocal within a window of time.
Yeah.
It's the Olympics.
It is.
It's the Olympics.
It's the Olympics.
It's Yes. the Olympics. And so the gift isn't just that. I mean, I'm saying this so that you're being humble because it's not easy. Like,
no,
you can write a great song
easy.
And send it off and hope that it gets done. But to make an artist, big or small, new or veteran, feel comfortable to bring out the best in them is another level of this business that most people still don't master.
Yeah.
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 It's a whole other level Wow. of doing this thing to be able to get people to bring out a hit record out of somebody. Is
and a lot of times, you know, those artists, they don't even want to sing their biggest record.
They don't want to sing it.
They don't even want to, you know, sometimes I may be sitting in the studio for 8 hours with them, just whatever they want to do. Okay, I'm here with you. All right, whatever you want to do, I'm here with you. Okay, you want to do this, you want to do that. Okay, how can I get you in the booth? Can we maybe bring the party in the booth without a microphone? Maybe we could do, you know?
I kind of blame Makeba because you have no idea how many times me and Chuck, or separately and together, have had fights about artists who didn't want to sing the song because they really wanted to sing Get Me Bodied.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I think you should do this song. Like, but I want something like, and I'm like, I don't think you should do Get Me Bodied.
No, don't do that. I know one of the people who wanted something like that.
Several want to upgrade you.
I'll leave them nameless.
I've been in many
today.
Sessions where I'm like, I was called here to write an R&B ballad, but you're telling me that now on the spot you want upgrade you. Yeah. And
that happened so many times.
And I'm like,
Lord.
Makeba, damn it.
So speaking of artists, like a lot of the people that you work with would be on most people's Mount Rushmore.
Yeah. Mm.
But I want you to exclude the people you work with and give me your Mount Rushmore of artists.
Ooh.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
The ultimate Makeba Mount Rushmore. Mm-hmm.
Wow. Wow. Okay.
I'm going to add to the artists, and I want a separate Mount Rushmore for
songwriters. Songwriters, please.
Oh.
If you will.
Wow.
If you will.
If you will.
If you will.
All right. Can I say top three, or does it have to be five?
No, four.
Okay. Artists. Okay. In no particular order.
It's Mount Rushmore. They're all side by side.
Are these like artists that like have inspired me, or artists that like
whatever you wanted
whatever
to be?
Whatever you want.
Okay. Mm-hmm. My Mount Rushmore of artists, I'm gonna say, coming in at number four. Coming in at number four, I would say Hall & Oates. Yeah. I grew up
high five me, please.
Listening to Hall & Oates.
I think that they're beefing right now, by the way.
Yeah. Yeah, wow.
Yeah, restraining orders and everything.
Oh, my gosh.
It's crazy.
Not Hall & Oates.
Hall & Oates, man. The greatest duo.
Agreed.
Ever. Yes. Okay, coming in at number three, I would say Chaka Khan. Mm. Man, that voice
new leader
right there.
Into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
That voice right there, that's something different,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I'm going to say Nas, okay. Who is like,
I like that.
One of my favorite all-time hip-hop artists. Mm-hmm. And coming in at number one is Miss Mary J. Blige.
Mary.
Man, listen.
Wow.
Mary. That one right there, Mary.
MJB.
MJB.
The Queen.
The Queen, the soundtrack to my teenage years. And then I got an opportunity to be in the studio with her, and it just solidified it for me.
Yeah,
like,
man.
Real life. Queen.
Yeah.
Queen. Real life for royalty.
Sure. Yeah. For sure.
And with a heart
yeah.
made of pure gold.
Yeah.
Right there.
So MJB, Nas,
Chaka.
And Hall
&
Oates.
And
Hall &
Oates. I love how every time someone does that's exactly how I imagine that's the essence of who you are.
And if I could add, can we add a what do you call it? An
honorable mention?
I would say John Mayer.
Ooh. That's not
John Mayer.
But the John Mayer house is like
because we love John Mayer around here.
His name has come up. I feel like 20 times.
When it comes to,
I don't know if you could care about songwriting and not like
and
John
not,
Mayer
and not like or have studied his music.
Yeah,
oh my god,
that man is a poet.
A poet.
So speaking of the poets, your songwriter, Mount Rushmore.
Okay. Yeah. So first would be John Mayer as a songwriter.
He makes both lists.
Yes, he makes both lists. I would say Linda Perry, the songwriter.
Wow.
I would say Dolly Parton. Okay. Don't play with that pen.
Don't play with it.
Don't play with
don't
that
play,
pen.
Don't play with it.
Don't no, play don't with do that pen.
Dolly's the truth.
Wow. John Mayer, Linda Perry, Dolly Parton.
Dolly Parton.
And coming up the rear.
Who's that fourth spot on the and Mount Rushmore songwriters?
Coming up the rear. His name escapes me, but he wrote Lady in My Life for Michael Jackson.
Rod Temperton.
But I mean, it's so many incredible songwriters. It's too many to. I've been inspired by so
many.
Too many.
Yeah.
You know?
Wow. Ooh.
This is good.
This
she kept it 100.
She kept it 100.
Yeah.
She kept it a buck.
This is the essence of who I am, you know? You know?
I would watch this podcast.
Okay.
He's like, I'm a fan.
Let's hope.
Listen.
We sound crazy.
I want to bring it to the present.
To the present.
For a second, because what you've been doing lately, along with still just writing bangers and hits for everyone out there, is you found a way to take all this knowledge, all this experience. Mm-hmm. Things you were asking about, but artist preparation, studio etiquette, all that stuff, and now create your next chapter.
Yeah.
Talk about it.
So the Young Dreamers Agency,
yes.
I created that when I moved here in 2018. I was going through a transition in my life, just moving from the West Coast here, and our family was growing, and really, I mean, honestly, for the longest time, I felt like I was 16 years old. Honestly, but when we moved here, adulthood really came and sat on my shoulders and said, okay, you know, these years are going by and it's time to expand. It's time to evolve. And we were talking about this earlier. Yeah. You cannot, if you're not growing, you're dying, right?
That's right.
If you're not doing something different and evolving, then you are doing yourself a disservice, right? And so I was trying to figure out, what am I going to do next? What do I want to do next? And doing a bunch of different things. But the Young Dreamers Agency became like a house for new and upcoming artists and singers to provide the resources that they need that labels just don't provide anymore. You know, when I first started, labels would give you a big marketing budget, like from the jump. If you go in and you blow the label away, you got a marketing budget, you got a video budget, you got a studio budget. Labels don't do that anymore, right?
None of it,
right? So artists have to find these things and do these things a la carte. And it's hard.
Yeah,
I think about myself, if I was, you know, a new artist and I had to shoot my own video and find the songs and have them mixed and mastered, I would be lost in the water. So I decided to create this agency to give back to those new artists, because who knows, it could be a young Rihanna out there. It could be a young Chris Brown out there.
There is. And they're going to come through
your doors. And a lot of times, these artists, they just don't have the resources. Mm-hmm. They just don't have the network.
Yeah.
And so that's what my company does. That's the mission, is providing these services and these resources for new artists.
So how do new artists get involved? Do they apply? Do they call you like you called Rodney?
Look, listen, I'm game for all of it. Go visit the website, tydca.co. I'm at Songs by Mac on Instagram. You know, just reach out.
Yeah.
Reach out. Don't be afraid to reach out.
That's that give back that I love.
Because
people need, you're right, it is a la carte now, and people need, artists are still really struggling for the resources, and it's expensive.
And then just trying to figure it out, trying to put together a plan. Like, okay, artists think, okay, I go in and I do a song, and next thing you know, it's on the radio. No, it don't work like that.
It's
a whole lot of steps in between that. And so we provide all of those services to show you, okay, this is how you're going to do your demo. This is how you're going to do your video. This is your digital marketing package. Mm-hmm. This is who we're going to pitch it to, the whole nine.
I love that.
Man. Yeah. This is good. Dropping them gems.
Gems.
We sound crazy.
Esther Roll.
Award.
I can feel him moving, moving, moving. I can feel him moving, 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 moving on the altar of my heart. Every now and then.
Looking at my role, it's about that time.
For the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award. Now, Makeba, welcome to the show. Welcome to this very illustrious, important segment. Mm. When we get to the end of the conversation, we like to give an excellence award to a black entertainer, writer, producer, artist, anywhere in the business that we feel doesn't get the flowers they deserve. Mm. The reason it's called the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award is what you just heard was a snippet from Esther Roll's gospel album that no one knew she had until Timon put us on. But it got us talking about how there's so many things that we are doing in our career that don't get highlighted.
Yeah.
Because we focus on maybe one or two people and not the whole. So that's what prompted us to start this segment where we all nominate someone and then we vote and we give the award. And so, because you're our guest this week, you're part of the voting. You're part of the...
Okay.
You're part of the Senate.
So I'll kick it off. My nomination this week is two amazing songwriters and producers out of Philadelphia. My friends, but they've done some greatness for so many people. Dre and Vidal.
Ooh. Oh, yeah. I love Dre and Vidal. Mm.
I like what you've done here.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So coming here to Atlanta, first, for whatever reason, I just landed on this man's album and I just went through the whole catalog. And I've always loved his music, and he's a master guitarist, talking about none other than George Benson.
Ooh. Okay. I see what you did there.
Yeah. Mm, that's a good one.
Ooh, all right. I'm going to nominate a songwriter as well, a woman who I think is brilliant. I'm currently watching her podcast, Syeda Garrett.
Okay. Ooh,
okay.
Love Syeda.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I feel like she when I think of powerful women songwriters who never get their just due for how influential they are. Right. You are one. Syeda is one of the trailblazers for me in my mind. So that's what I'm nominating.
Okay. I'm gonna nominate my St. Louis brother that I get mistaken for all the time, Sterling K. Brown.
Yo, they be thinking he's every time
it's crazy.
Like, when the airport, they're like, Sterling? I'm like,
I get preferential treatment because people think I'm Sterling K. Brown, and I don't look nothing like Sterling K. Brown, but I'm going to nominate him.
Does it look like Sterling K. Brown to you?
No.
I'm opening not you.
I'm going to do a side-by-side on social media.
No.
Yeah. Y'all could be distant cousins.
No, especially since he's from St. Louis.
He's from St. Louis?
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy. All right, last but not least.
Oh, okay, I got to nominate somebody. Okay, gosh, I was just thinking of somebody. Oh, you know who I would like to nominate? I'm going to nominate an executive, right? Can it be an executive?
Yeah.
A young black executive who I met 20 years ago, and he really believed in me and has been a champion for me and many, many, many songwriters and producers and creatives for all the years that I've known him. Wardell Malloy. I'm going to nominate Wardell Malloy.
Yeah. I love that.
Wody Malloy.
So this is a tough one. So we got, just to recap, Dre and Vidal, George Benson, Syeda Garrett, Sterling K. Brown, and Wardell Malloy.
All right.
So we can vote as many times as you want. And then if we get the tie, we'll do the tiebreaker. But first go around, you can vote as many times as you want.
Okay.
Dre and Vidal, show of hands. Okay. George Benson.
All right.
Syeda Garrett. Sterling K. Brown. Wardell Malloy.
That's a no-brainer.
Wow. All right, Wardy. Shout out to Wardy, man.
Shout out to Wardell.
Listen, Wardell is the reason why he was one of the first people to find me. He found me in the studio in New York.
Me too.
He's like, you're BMI, come with me. I got you.
And actually, Wardell's who connected us.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's been looking out for me ever since.
Yeah, me too.
Man, congratulations, Wardell Malloy, the winner this week of the Esther Roll Black Excellence Award.
Yeah, deserves
some noise.
We sound crazy.
Makeba, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, y'all.
This was great. Honor to have you.
Yeah. So much wisdom. Gems.
Gems.
Gems on gems.
Listen, wow. Thank you for having me. This is, we have so much history. I mean,
so much history.
Probably 15 plus years now. So to be sitting down on this side of the game with y'all
right.
Yeah, is like, wow. Full circle.
We did all right. We did all right.
We did okay.
Because I kept following Makeba. When she was in New York, I was in New York. And then when she moved to LA, I went west. Right. And then you went to Atlanta, I went to Nashville. Right. So it just, you know.
So basically, Phil is stalking
me. Right? Yeah, I take it. I welcome it.
That's what's really going on
my
here.
My sister right there. Make sure you follow us on all platforms at We Sound Crazy everywhere, wesoundcrazy.com. Thank you, thank you, thank you to Visit Music City for your continued support. Always. Much love.
Makeba, when we leave, we ask our special guests to pick a song to take us out. It could be any song that you feel like is on your mind right now or encapsulates the conversation.
Now I have a song on my mind, but it doesn't really encapsulate this conversation. But you know what I was just thinking about? If you think you're lonely now.
But wait, which version?
The KC version from Joe.
That's what I was about to ask you.
That right there, listen.
That's a great way.
Is that a great way? I don't want it to be.
That's a great song. That's a classic.
That's a classic yeah, right there. And I was just thinking, like, this is such a classic moment.
Yeah,
we're going to look back on this.
Yeah,
and all the you know, young executives and songwriters and producers, they're going to look at this and say, wow, that's a classic conversation right there.
I love
classic
that.
Classic conversation. I like that.
Classic conversations with Makeba Riddick.
That's right.
I love that title.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you think you're lonely now, we out here, y'all. Till next week. We sound crazy.
I'm gonna dedicate this song to all the lovers in the world tonight. And I expect that to be the whole world because